Coming up right now, the newest episode from Carr, Gwyn, and Ode on Three Pagans and a Cat.
The path that leadeth on is lighted by one fire, the light of daring burning in the heart. The more one dares, the more he shall attain. Welcome to Fire Festival's Beltane, the 39th episode of Three Pagans and a Cat. Our opening today is courtesy of 19th century occultist Helena Blavatsky. You may call me Ode.
You can call me Carr. I'm Ode's father.
Merry meet. My name is Gwyn, Ode's mother. And I love Blavatsky.
It's a good quote.
It's a great quote. And I love, there's one book that she wrote that is something baboon.
Madame Blavatsky. Yes. Baboon, yeah.
Yeah, and I love that book.
Okay, so we're going to do our...
I can't believe we're at 39 episodes.
I was going to say the same thing. It's like, holy shit, 39?
I know, the numbers just keep going up.
They just keep going up. I guess that's a
good thing. The numbers are going up double fast right now because we're also putting in the interviews on our off weeks.
Plus, we also had that one Fool's Gold episode.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so we've had a sort of an artificial jump in the number of our episodes right now.
But. Right, and I hope everybody enjoyed the Fool's Gold. I've listened to it a couple of times just because it makes me laugh.
Let's move on to our maintenance stuff so we can get that out of the way.
Do we have any new patrons? New patrons, yes. We have one kitten.
Oh, we love you, kitten.
Hello, new kitten.
We have one new cat. That's Megan Sokolow.
Hello, Megan. Thank you for supporting us.
And we have four new hunters.
Wow.
Robin Archer, who's on Discord right now.
Yep, he's in the Discord
Robin.
With us.
Mistina, Meredith Kenton, and Susan Johnson, who just upgraded to Hunter from Kitten.
Kitten. Made a big jump.
Wow, yep. Thank you so much. And thank you to everyone who...
To all of our patrons.
To everyone who supports us through Patreon. We really appreciate your support.
Mm-hmm. And an extra special shout out to Squeaky, who I forgot last podcast.
Our beloved Squeaky.
So Squeaky, thank you very much.
Squeaky is a Hunter level patron who is not supporting us through Patreon, but made a one-time, like, year-long donation, essentially, to us directly, and therefore got Hunter access for a year.
Yep. And we certainly do appreciate it, and we love our Squeaky.
Yes, Squeaky's in the Discord almost every recording.
Oh, absolutely.
Almost every day.
Yeah, so it's true. In the live patron questions channel in particular, Squeaky is almost always there when we're recording, so we're very fond of Squeaky.
That's right.
Other regulars.
I think I should
love
a commercial.
All our regulars.
You think you're going to
start
a commercial?
I think I should. Yeah, might as well.
All right.
Okay, commercial time.
Commercial time. Now for a commercial from our Tiger Lorelei for the Georgia-based shop Otherworld Creations, featuring jewelry, altar pieces, devotional art, and decorative items fashioned out of bones, teeth, claws, and fur of departed creatures. Lorelei believes that these remains have their own energy and spirit the same way that plants and stones do, and that these can be tapped into and worked with. Most of the remains used in Otherworld Creations are found already dead, and some are traded from hunters who would otherwise discard these remnants. You can follow Otherworld Creations on Instagram at otherworld_creationsco, or find them on Facebook, or you can contact them at otherworldcreationsco@gmail.com for inquiries or commissions.
Heck yeah.
Huzzah.
Commercial one, out of the way.
Commercial one. And it's a great store. I checked it out.
Yeah, the stuff that's on that Instagram is very choice.
Very choice stuff. Highly recommend you guys go check it out and get some stuff.
Yeah.
Because it's cool.
For whatever Lorelei can actually ship you.
That's right.
Yeah, yes, because there's all these rules. All these rules about shipping bones and things.
Yeah.
But Lorelei has exhibited on the Discord in the past an extremely close familiarity with those rules.
All the rules.
So
Lorelei knows what the fuck she's doing.
Yeah, exactly. You won't get in any trouble because Lorelei knows what's up.
Seriously, check out her website. She's got beautiful creations, and you'll find something you need or want.
Yep.
Okay, are we ready to get going?
Yeah, I think we are.
Okay, so as the title of this episode indicates, we are continuing our sort of deeper dive on the Wheel of the Year, now with Beltane, which is the next fire festival.
It is indeed.
And it's funny because in preparation for this episode, I've been listening to our previous Beltane episode.
So did I.
And I didn't realize we covered that really, really well. So I was sitting there going, what are we going to talk about this time?
Well, I think, this is obviously the challenge with the series, is that we scraped sort of the surface of these holidays in that first year when we did the Wheel of the Year series.
Yep.
And now the challenge is to kind of dig deeper and get into sort of the bones of the thing.
Right. What's like, the deeper meaning?
Right. Like, what's the point of the holiday? Mm-hmm. Not just like the trappings of the holiday, right. The mechanics of the holiday, but like, why do you celebrate it?
Well, and I think, you know, on the surface, it's, you know, it's a fertility holiday. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people focus on the sexual aspect
the
of
great
it.
Rite and the great rite and the maypole are a very dramatic aspect of
exactly,
this holiday.
Exactly. All the phallic symbols associated
and
with
I,
it.
And I think maybe this episode last year, I think maybe the Wheel of the Year Beltane episode was where the dick wand.
Right, the preopic wand.
Yeah. That was where we started talking about the dick wand.
I thought that was Ostara.
No, I think it was Beltane.
Okay. Well, yeah, I think you're right.
Yeah.
So it's
and
very,
maybe also the dick bread.
Yes, I think so. with the cheese.
Mm-hmm.
So, it was a good idea. That's what you think of when you think of Beltane.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things that has really been jumping out at me mm-hmm. when I was kind of re-listening to the episode and looking up some resources again was two ideas. The first one was the taking your livestock and yourself mm-hmm. through these two bonfires so that the smoke would just swirl around them and cleanse them and protect them for the coming year. So
right.
mm-hmm. obviously cleansing and protecting is a big feature of this.
Because I think it is worth pointing out that the ancient celebrations of Beltane in Ireland and in mm-hmm. Scotland, in that area,
mm-hmm.
were very different from the celebrations mm-hmm. we do now for, like, the May Day with the maypole
right,
and everything.
Maypole,
right,
yep.
Like, for instance, they would extinguish their fires and they'd relight their fires.
Well, they'd build the need fire,
yeah,
which
yep.
was a fire that you had to build in a specific way.
Mm-hmm.
It was more work than traditional, and then all the hearths had to be relit with mm-hmm. the sparks from that
the,
fire.
Right, exactly. Yep. So, I mean, it was obviously a very, very important
mm-hmm.
ritual for them.
And it was much less focused on like human fertility,
right?
And much more focused on sort of livestock and agricultural fertility.
Yeah, the fertility of the land, because at this point in that part of the world, you know, they were kind of in the middle of their spring, I think.
Well, they were so Beltane wasn't really like spring wasn't a concept that
right.
really existed back in the day. It was
right.
like winter and summer. The world
right.
had Two halves.
Light and
dark.
And it was
just
working
your way from one into
right.
the other. So
right.
Beltane was the point where you were definitively moving into summer.
Right.
Right.
This
right.
was the mark that summer was happening.
Yeah.
And that big fire was most of the time built in one place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
notice?
Yeah. It was mm-hmm. one big
yep,
bonfire.
It was in County Westmeath.
Yep.
All of Ireland mm-hmm. would go there. To get that fire to relight their
And when
their
you
hearts.
Think about that, that means that all these different clans were coming together.
Yeah,
exactly.
So that would be an excellent time to marry
right.
people from different
but it was,
tribes.
But it was also a time when, like,
peace out.
It was also a time when legal disputes were settled.
Right. Yep.
Because
right.
it was when all your lawmakers and all your judges
together.
Were all in one place.
Could meet
druids.
Together.
Your druids, yeah.
Right.
We're all,
yeah.
We're all
yeah.
in one place.
Yeah.
To render judgments.
Yep.
So if you
been.
Had disputes during the winter,
mm-hmm.
you tabled those things
yep.
until Beltane, when everyone was going to be together and you could all handle it. And also, at that point, winter was a time where everyone had to sort of suck it up and work together.
Right.
Right.
And then summer was when you could start going to war again.
Right.
Summer was when you could afford to start shedding blood again. During
mm-hmm.
the winter, you couldn't afford to lose anybody because
right.
you all had to,
right.
you know,
pitch in
to make it through what in some places, at least certainly in Scandinavia, were extremely harsh and dangerous winters
yep.
mm-hmm.
That were going to be killing people in your tribe anyway. So, like, mm-hmm. don't add to the body count.
Right.
So all that stuff had to wait until, you know,
yeah.
in Ireland, until Beltane, in
That's
Scandinavia,
right.
until the thing.
And you talked about, you know, people walking between the fire.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It was considered to be better fertility and, like, just make you have more luck during the year if
mm-hmm.
you chose to leap.
Mm,
yeah,
Beltane
yeah,
the Beltane
yeah.
fire.
Yeah.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Of course, you couldn't leap your livestock through, but
no, but
yeah, if you could,
yeah, if you could,
had the courage to take a running jump over the bonfire,
right.
yeah.
Yep.
Which, and I've seen, you know, some modern practitioners
mm-hmm.
do have taken up that practice, and it's a really like dramatic thing to watch.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen some video,
yeah.
and especially if you've got people who are dressed in antlers and
mm-hmm.
and in finery, you know, and hopefully not long skirts, and. you know, jumping over these
Just get all
fires.
Your clothes wet before you take them
right. It's actually, it's really a dramatic thing to watch.
And all of that was actually done on Beltane or May.
Yeah. And then the partying essentially continued through to.
I think it's important to maybe, you know, get past the dick bread. And
as hilarious as the
as
dick
hilarious
bread
as it is. And start to maybe look at these deeper aspects of
because in
luck
modern,
and protection as well as mediation.
Exactly. And in modern paganry, right, in modern pagan circles, the fertility is very much that surface level, easy scrape access to the holiday.
Absolutely.
But especially if you're in a Reconstructionist tradition, which, like, I'm not. I'm in a Revivalist tradition. I'm fine accepting new stuff.
Sure.
But if you're in a Reconstructionist tradition, it doesn't make any sense to pursue, like, a really fertility-focused Beltane, because that's not what the ancients were doing.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yep.
But it could be a great time if there's some quarrels going on in your group or between family members or something like that. Beltane could be a great time to get a third party to come in and help mediate and kind of overcome some of these, you know, some of these difficult relationship issues that you could be. So, and even in families, like, this could be a good time
to hash out some
differences or some things to bring that peace and unity back into your family
and relationships. And I think it's really important and significant there that you mentioned a third party.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's a tendency, especially in covens, to kind of handle things in-house. Mm-hmm. And kindreds have the same thing too. To handle things inside the kindred, inside the coven, and not let outsiders see your dirty laundry, right?
Right, right.
But Beltane is specifically about getting everybody, your whole, like, extended tribal group together, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So that outside participants who are still part of your in culture,
right,
but are not part of your immediate group,
right,
can weigh in on this problem from a slightly outside perspective.
So from Druidry of today, all of the groves would come together.
Exactly.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And then instead of just an individual grove handling its shit and, you know, having to deal with the natural biases, because there's, human beings, we're always going to have natural biases.
Right.
But if you get outsiders involved,
mm-hmm.
who are enough in the in-group that they know, you know, everyone has the same sort of rules and expectations, but aren't directly involved with the immediate group.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You can, I think you'll get a lot more productive conflict resolution that way.
Mm-hmm. And I think it could also be, I don't know if people have done this in, like, groves and kindreds and covens, but, like, if you have a sister coven or a sister grove or kindred, what, you know, you could get several groups together to celebrate Beltane together, you know, to make it, to kind of revive that spirit
and I wonder
of
if
camaraderie
something,
and coming together.
And I wonder if something productive to do would be come together, get a bunch of kindreds together, right? Mm-hmm. Celebrate your Beltane.
Right.
Not that kindreds really do Beltane, but if they did, let's just assume kindreds are doing Beltane.
Right, sure.
Get a bunch of kindreds together to do Beltane before you do the celebration part. Like, do an opening writ or whatever to say, and now we're here all together to celebrate Beltane.
Right.
In the spirit of whatever. Do all your conflict resolution at
first,
the beginning.
Yeah.
Get it out of the way. And then do those rebind those ties and that community, rebuild that frith.
Right.
Through the rest of the Beltane event as you all celebrate together.
Yeah.
It's way easier to party when all of the crap
when all the shit's
away.
Already been dealt
exactly.
with.
Yep. Exactly.
Yeah. This seems to me like, and I guarantee to you that most Beltane events don't have this, like, conflict resolution component.
Right.
But they should.
And I think it would be really smart if we could, sort of integrate this into at least Beltane.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If at least on this holiday, when everyone's, you know, blood is up anyway, just get the shit out in the open, talk about it, hash it out, figure out what you're going to do about it, and then, when it's been dealt with, move on, reconnect, get back to loving each other as family.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, on the morning of May 1st, people would rise at dawn, and they would collect flowers and boughs from, like, mountain ash and rowan trees, and they would put those across doorways or on the outside of the windows
garlands,
of their home and that kind of stuff. Yep. And so the usual traditions of hospitality and generosity, though, are kind of turned on their heads during Beltane.
Mm.
Basically, anything taken from a home on Beltane could be used for malicious spells against the owner. So guests were turned away at the door. But since we were just talking about flowers and ash and rowan and that kind of stuff, I think it's time for Gwyn's Garden Gems.
Okay. So, what I'm going to be talking about today is cowslip, which was also known as Fairy Cup, as well as Freya's Key. Official name is Primula Veris. It is a yellow flower that grows on a tall green stalk, and it's really got like almost a green ball that the blossoms kind of come up out of in a bunch.
Like a comet.
Yeah, it's a quite a beautiful flower. It's very bright yellow, common to Great Britain and Europe. It was very useful and particularly grown in medieval gardens. Mm. They had a lot of uses for it. It is associated, as far as its associations modern day, obviously with Freya, because one of its names is Freya's Key. It's also associated with water and the planet Venus. It's good for protection magic, for unlocking secrets, hence Freya's Key, and healing. And then some of the traditions that grew up around cowslip: if you wear a cowslip flower, it will preserve youthfulness for the coming year.
Okay.
You can also, I thought this was funny, especially considering they would use cowslip, you know, on their doors and, mm-hmm. and things
in the
like
garlands.
That. And if you put cowslip under your door or under your porch, it discourages visitors. Also, farmers would take the petals from the cowslip and rub them on the cow's udders,
okay,
to prevent milk thieving fairies from getting the milk for the remainder of the
sense.
Year.
Yep.
But cowslip is also said to be a favorite of the fairy folk. Thought that was kind of an interesting thing that they would use it to discourage fairies. When it was considered
like
to be a favored flower.
These seem like folklores that probably come from different regions.
Probably, yeah. Probably. It's also, you can hang it over your door for good luck as well as protection. It can also be used to invoke love and attraction, which is another reason why it was popular for Beltane. It is a spring flower, so it comes up in April and May. You can find it mostly when it's growing wild in fields, meadows, coastal dunes, cliff tops. But if you do want to sow cowslip in your garden, the best time to sow the seed is in the autumn, obviously before it,
then
you
it
have a hard right
then, yeah.
over the winter, and it should hopefully then spring up. It grows to be about 10 inches tall.
Okay.
So it's not a huge flower.
No, that's
it's,
a respectable flower
it's
an, size.
It's a respectable
it's not a geranium
size
or something.
Exactly. But if you don't want to worry about sowing the seed, you can get what's plug plants, basically plants that have already been grown to a couple of inches,
right,
and just plug them into the spaces you want in your garden.
That's how I prefer to do plants.
Yeah. And they do prefer good soil in sun or partial shade. The scent is a lot like anise, you know,
so licorice-y.
Kind of a licorice-y.
Yep.
And the leaves and flowers can be added to salads. The leaves can be cooked like spinach and or added to soups or stews. The flower blossom only, not the green part of the blossom,
right,
but just the yellow petals, can be made into a tea that's good for headache remedy, dizziness, chills, head colds, cramps, nerve pain, as well as to help you relax if
so
you've had
nightmares.
So it sounds
like it's nightmares. Just a general analgesic.
Yeah, a good general relaxant and analgesic. It can also be made into country wine and vinegars. Mm-hmm. It's added to these two things for that. So anyway, it's a wonderful little plant. Get you some and put it on your altar and above your door so that you don't have unwanted, or under your porch so you don't have unwanted guests.
We need to plant cowslip because I never want guests.
I do actually want to plant some cowslip.
For your apothecary?
Yeah, for my apothecary, but also just, you know, there's some really neat things you can do with it.
That's it for Gwyn's Garden Gems.
Thank you.
So some other weird traditions from Beltane.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Walking the circuit of your property, which is called beating the bounds.
Okay.
And that's to repair all the fences and boundary markers.
Right, yeah, that makes sense.
Which makes a ton of sense.
After the winter.
Right, yep.
Yeah.
Well, and during winter, you can't get out there to take care of this shit, so it gets,
right,
you know, wrecked.
Growing up, we had horses. My mom would always walk the fence. I don't know if she knew she was doing a Beltane thing, but, you know.
So according to the ancient Irish Book of Invasions,
okay,
Partholon, who was the first settler of Ireland,
okay,
arrived on May 1st.
Mm-hmm.
And it was on May 1st that a plague came and destroyed his entire people.
Huh. Good job, Partholon.
Years later, the mythical group known as the Malaysians were said to have conquered the Tuatha Dé Danann on May Day.
May Day is a cursed day in Ireland,
or
it sounds like.
Day.
Or a good day.
Good or bad, you know. Yeah. It's
it
that in between.
Your
we're balancing It's that balancing act.
Yeah, so one thing I thought we should talk about is that so because Beltane is exactly 6 months out from Samhain, mm-hmm. they are essentially mirror holidays.
And they are both liminal times.
Sure, yeah, all mm-hmm. the holidays are liminal times.
True. But
so because Beltane and Samhain are, they do this sort of like flip-flop mm-hmm. where right. Beltane is, and now it's summer, and Samhain is, and mm-hmm. now it's winter. They are sort of mirror images of each other. And so they have very similar intensities of energy, mm-hmm. even though they have inverted focuses.
Right.
So where Samhain is very focused on death.
Right.
And on dealing with the dead.
Mm-hmm.
Beltane is very focused on
life.
Life. And to a certain extent, even birth, like mm-hmm. activation, the mm-hmm. beginning of, not the beginning in the sense that Imbolc is, which right. is like conception, mm-hmm. right? Like mm-hmm. the seed of the thing.
Right.
But
right.
birth, like, the and actual, now you exist.
Right, exactly. I think it's interesting because, you know, there's the Samhain tradition of trick-or-treating, you
right,
know,
yes.
and causing mayhem and mischief. Beltane, what they would do was, and we talked about this in the previous mm-hmm. episode too, is they would take gifts to their neighbors. And one of the things that I really thought was charming was the May basket, is they would fill it with flowers and home goods and things like that. And they would take it to their shut-ins, their elderlies, the people who were too sick to come out to the celebrations, that kind of thing. So I thought that was
presumably they also had to bring them a piece of the fire.
Right. And they yeah. would bring them a piece of from the fire.
Yep.
And I thought that was a beautiful way to include these people into the greater community mm-hmm. who may be outliers simply because of age or infirmity.
Yeah.
And I think we talked about this in the previous Beltane episode, but when the fires were completely dead,
mm-hmm.
that ash is what they used yes. to fertilize their
to
fields.
Fertilize yep. their fields.
So,
which I think is beautiful.
Yep.
That's very cool.
Yep.
So also thorn trees, I don't know if you all know this, but thorn trees are very connected to the fairy kingdom.
Yes. Oh.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were decorated on May Day with flowers, ribbons, and painted shells.
Okay.
Well, so, listen, if you don't invite the neighbors, they'll come anyway. So
right, exactly.
You might as well start on good terms.
Start yep. on good terms with the good neighbors.
They're going to be here for the party whether you invite them or not, so you right. better right. invite them.
Well, I wonder if that's how we came up with the maple.
Because I think didn't Jason Mankey wrote a blog
article,
post
yeah.
not that long ago saying that the maple is not as old as we think it is.
Correct.
Is that
yeah. correct?
It's a relatively recent.
So relatively, yeah. Yeah. you know, within several
it's
hundred years.
It's fairly widespread in Europe.
Yeah.
It's not like new. It's not like 19th century new.
No.
Right.
No,
but it
yeah.
is like 16th, 17th
yeah.
century.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah. yeah.
In, and I think where it comes from is going to vary regionally. Right. So like German countries,
mm-hmm.
it probably comes from Irminsul, which is the world pillar. Like that's a known
right.
older symbol.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I suspect that at least in German areas, either, and it's the timelines on these are fuzzy. So it's hard to say, like, did it start in Celtic speaking areas and spread east towards Germany? Did
right.
it start in German speaking areas and spread west towards Ireland?
And we know that the Celts were great traders.
Exactly.
So
and these, and
these,
so were the Germans.
Exactly.
And so there were a lot of, there was a lot of
cross-cultural
sharing
right,
happening.
Yeah.
yeah.
So it could very well be some sort of like fusion or interaction between
right.
like decorating the thorn trees and mm-hmm. Irminsul, the world pillar,
right.
you
yeah.
know, colliding.
Together,
this could
yeah.
be
yeah.
one of those, you know, which came first, the chicken or the egg,
uh-huh.
we'll never really know kind of situations.
yeah, but that is an interesting correlation for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah. It is very interesting.
And because I think thorn trees are not, you couldn't make a maypole out of a thorn tree.
No.
No,
they're a smaller, bushier kind of
correct.
A,
yeah. Yeah.
of a tree,
and very kind, they're not straight.
Yeah,
at
they're
all.
They're
yeah.
craggly.
Yeah.
So you would have to use something else, and I wonder. So yeah, so I wonder if thing like the Irminsul as that very straight pillar
mm-hmm. yep.
concept
mm-hmm.
combined with decorate the tree
right.
for
became,
fertility and
right.
luck.
Right.
Yeah, that would be an it would not be surprising, I guess,
right.
if those
yeah.
concepts
yeah.
interacted in some way to create the maypole. Especially mm-hmm. when you look at things like traditional Anglo-Saxon maypoles that had the crown at the top,
mm-hmm.
the wreath at the top.
Yep.
Yeah. And of course, in addition to the fertility and the birthing of
mm-hmm.
things, you also, I was just thinking about the divination that would go on during that time. For instance, because I forgot to mention with the cowslip, there was a divination game that young children, well, not young children, but children and people would play to determine who they would marry.
Because everyone was obsessed with who they were going to marry back in the day.
No,
and so that seems to be a common theme in all of these festivals, is the types of divination they tended toward had to do, especially in things like Beltane.
Or at least the ones that were written down.
Yeah, right. The
ones that we were aware of have to do with, well, who's going to marry who, and that kind of thing.
And they're just little, they're folk divinations, right? So they're no more, I guess, the extent to which they're genuinely divinatory depends on the approach you take. But, basically the same as, like, pulling petals off a flower.
Oh, sure, right. Absolutely. Yeah. And this game, especially, since basically the object of the game was to toss the green part of the flower around until it disintegrated.
Yeah. While it pops.
While you sang a rhyme about who you were going to marry, kind of thing. So
Squeaky's mentioning playing MASH in elementary school. Yeah, exactly. Those little paper pyramid things.
Yeah. Exactly. And it's a similar.
I never had to do that.
But I think it's those types of things, you know, like bobbing for apples and all those kind of those games.
Peeling the apples to see
what the name of your intended was going to be, that kind of thing.
Did you all also know that the morning dew on May Day was more potent?
Yes, because you mentioned it last year.
Oh, there it is.
You did.
And we talked about washing your face.
Washing your face with the May Day dew.
Mm-hmm.
Did you know that young maidens rolled in it?
No.
To stay more young and beautiful?
No, but
they would actually roll across the ground.
Now, if we
added something new to the podcast for this year.
And like in the previous episode, you were like, is there a way to collect the dew? I got to thinking about that. Actually, what you could do is put a piece of cloth out and it would collect dew, and then you could take that and wash your face.
Maybe.
Yeah,
I guess it would depend on the fibers you had.
It would have to be like a piece of cotton. Like a clean piece of cotton cloth.
Yeah.
And lay it out on the grass. Trust me, I used to go camping. I know, things get wet.
They get damp.
And damp.
Yes.
So,
but do they get damp enough to wash your face with?
Well, I don't think you're like washing, like, you know, like getting really wet.
Well, I think it depends on how dewy it is.
That's true.
And I think it's just a matter of the
symbolic.
Just
swipe this damp cloth over your face.
It's the symbolism of it. I'm going to try it if we don't have ice.
Yeah, I was going to say. As it stands.
Right now, you could roll out there, but you'd be damned.
You'd regret your choices.
There would be no dew.
No.
Right. But we still have a few weeks.
The dew is buried under an inch of snow right now.
Yeah, last year was ice. This year it's snow. It's like, what the fuck? Come on.
Yeah.
Honestly. Really?
Really?
Third winter. So it goes.
God damn it.
So Beltane, I think, even more than Imbolc, for me at least, has like really strong fire feelings.
Yeah, well, it is definitely.
Like, Imbolc is a fire festival, and it's got fire associations through Brigid, because Brigid really likes fire, right?
Right.
But I think of, and I was thinking about this, so like I'm with these spring festivals, my struggle is like, okay, well, I don't want to celebrate three fertility festivals in a row.
Right, which we've talked about.
Exactly. Yeah, I'm like, this bores me.
Yeah.
So what alternative reasons can I find to celebrate these holidays? And so where I landed on Imbolc was purification.
Right.
And where I landed on Ostara was celebration.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So for Beltane, I think where I'm ending is a much more, and all three of these are sort of fire aspects, right?
Mm-hmm.
The purifying aspect of fire, the joyous aspect of fire.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm getting to what I'm calling activation, or like that magician energy from the tarot, where you're actualizing your potential into a thing.
Right.
In a way that can be almost like frenzied, very, very active and productive.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's maybe even the most like primal element of fire, is just the almost destructiveness of
it. The combustion of it.
Exactly. That the action of the fire.
Mm-hmm.
Not for any specific purpose, but just because that's what fire is.
Right. Fire can, you know, obviously it can destroy, but it can also help create.
Mm-hmm.
It can assist in the creation because
When properly harnessed,
you know, kilns with baking clay, obviously an oven with baking food.
Mm-hmm.
Anything,
the forge.
Yeah. Or making athames or swords or whatever.
Or whatever your tools
are. Whatever you need made out of iron.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you can harness that energy, there's a lot you can create with fire.
Well, and magically speaking, just fire is considered a creative force as much as it's considered a destructive
one. That's right. You want to work with fire if you're going to be creating the energy of the element of fire.
Yeah. So that's where I'm landing on this holiday, I think, is focusing on that activity, that
creative
that,
energy.
Yeah, that creative energy, that driving forward, passion, I guess.
Mm-hmm. I like that. I think for me, for some reason, the protection aspect is jumping out at me a lot with the smoke. So I think I would probably think about...
You want a fire, you can throw a lot of things on to smoke up.
Exactly. I'd be thinking of, you know, protection for the house, protection for the family, cowslip under the porch to, you know...
To ward off guests.
To ward off unwanted visitors, you know, things like that. Protecting of the home space seems to be what is really standing out to me. That and being generous and to those who are shut in or can't participate in some for some reason.
Your desire to, like... create the safe home space sort of matches that mending the fences, walking the boundaries, stuff that Carr was talking about earlier. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And I've already decided I think I'm going to put together a May basket, take it at least one to my mom and maybe, you know, if there's anybody else I can think of who might like one.
Squeaky said there are pine cones that won't open until they go through fire.
Yep.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
And apparently Robin Archer and Mermediff are going to be making do stuff.
That's a great idea.
I don't know how you are going to accomplish that, but you all get to it.
Yep, feel and free. Then let us know how it works out. Because I think that's a great idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm always interested to hear about the stuff y'all are making.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You all, speaking of creativity, you all are so freaking creative and productive.
That's right.
Yeah. I'm very impressed with the work that the Pride does.
It's time for reviews!
Did that hurt?
No. I was going to say, it sounded like you were a little hoarse or something.
Looked like it was real high up there in your register face was a little red.
It didn't hurt. That was fine. But my voice is hoarse.
It is a little hoarse, yeah.
Because I yelled and screamed at this stupid convention thing I went to. Because they required us to.
I should have given you some of my elderberry syrup. I'll give you some. That could help.
Okay.
But anyway, what we are actually going to be talking about a couple of things today.
We're going to start with a book.
Yep.
We are reviewing Keeping Her Keys, An Introduction to Hecate by Cindy Brannan.
And it's actually Introduction to Hecate's Modern Witchcraft.
Okay.
Because it's actually a course, a year and a day course in this book. You want to become a devotee and accept the first key of Hecate. You can follow this book and start that relationship, which is something that I am doing. You know, I started on the new moon by following the ritual that was in the book. So, and it's Cindy Brannan is the author, and she's been a practicing witch for something like, I think, 30 years.
A good long while.
And she's been a Hecatean witch for, you know, probably close to that, or somewhere in the last 20 years. And she teaches and obviously writes blogs and things like that. And it was through those classes and through her blog posts that this book came about.
Gotcha.
I really like it. I don't know if you guys have read it.
I read it and I did not care for it.
Well, that's okay. Oh, I see you over there. I can tell.
I'm just like,
She's like,
I'm not a fan of this book.
I liked this book because it does teach you the steps toward modern Hecatean witchcraft, which from the way it's presented is, you know, it's open to anyone. If you already have deities, that's cool. If you want to incorporate Hecate into your pantheon, you can do that. If you want to just honor Hecate, that's cool too. You just and there's exercises and steps, different types of meditations and rituals and things that you can do to learn how to become a Hecatean witch,
right?
Basically.
What was your issue with it?
Okay.
Because I did not read it.
Okay.
Because I spent all my time, you know, doing business.
I had a couple of issues with this book.
Mm-hmm.
The first thing, and probably the thing that put me on the back foot starting with this book, is that very early on, she refers to Hecate as the queen of the underworld. And that is not Hecate. That is Persephone.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sorry, she can't have that title. It belongs to someone else.
Well, she is a goddess of the underworld. That's how I understand it. She's a goddess of the underworld. She and she is the queen of the witches. But she's gotten a lot, and these are taken from historical sources. that have, you know, have recognized.
Hecate is referred to as the queen of the underworld once in the Greek magical papyri, which are not like reputable Hellenistic sources.
There's also other sources that say she was a companion to.
Yes, that's the actual myth. So here's the actual myth. Persephone is abducted into the underworld by Hades. Demeter goes searching for her. Hecate is a friend of Demeter. So Hecate helps Demeter search for Persephone. And because Hecate has these torches, she's able to find Persephone in the underworld. And then later on, Hecate becomes an attendant of Persephone. But Hecate is not the queen of the underworld. Persephone is the queen of the underworld. This is like, and I have strong feelings about this, even though I'm not Hellenistic.
Clearly you do. It's like, chill the fuck out over there.
No, I won't. I have strong feelings about this. I don't worship the Hellenic deities, but I do feel like I have an attachment to Persephone and Hades, and my blood gets up when they get disrespected. That happens a lot, and I'm mad about it.
Well, you know.
So anyway, this put me on the back foot for this book.
Okay.
And I was on the back foot for this book through the whole thing, because it started out with this claim that Hecate was the queen of the underworld. And it continues a little further into the book to claim that, like, Hecate's hounds are the guardians of the underworld, so I guess now Cerberus is her dog. So, like, this, like, it, there's a few layers of this. And I'm almost positive that all of this actually comes down to UPG, because Cindy Brannan says somewhere in the introduction that there's a lot of UPG in this book.
Yeah, and she does say that.
Yes. And I'm fine with that. This is not a reconstructionist tradition.
No.
But you have to separate out, in my opinion, you have to separate out your sourced material from your UPG, and she does not do that. They are very blended together.
Okay.
So it's very difficult to sort out what a reconstructionist Hellenic worshiper would recognize from what's just Cindy Brannan's work.
Would footnotes have helped to say,
yes,
you know, and one there were, UPG,
there
two
were a couple of footnotes in this book, but not nearly enough. Not nearly enough to clarify what was her personal gnosis and what was sourced material.
Gotcha.
And in my opinion, this book desperately needed that. I also found it kind of muddy. Like, going through the chapters, because I read the whole book. Going through the chapters, I found it very repetitive. Like, I found that she repeated almost verbatim, like, whole sections of this book over and over again. And I don't know if that was intentional for emphasis.
I think it probably, when you remember that this is a book that is intended to be a course, a workbook-type course in how to become a modern Hecatean witch, how to incorporate devotion or how to work with Hecate in your personal craft. So yeah, there is repetition because you go through these things by
but
month.
There's, yes, but basically, there's repetition even in one chapter, right? Which should be like one lesson, right?
Yep.
So there's like large, but there's like whole paragraphs that are repeated and just, you know, very lightly rephrased. I just found it muddy and difficult to work through. Like it wasn't clearly
that's
written.
Fair.
I didn't like the style of the writing.
Yeah, that's fair. I, on the other hand, because I am working through it, that doesn't bother me. I appreciate the repetition. I would agree that it would be nice to have a notation of what is based on historical data and what is personal gnosis, rather than this kind of blending of the two.
Yeah. Right.
That would be nice.
And
but on the other hand, I'm planning to do separate research. There are a lot of books on Hecate out there.
Yeah.
So I'm planning to do, you know, personal research so I understand better what Hecate's individual mythology is.
Right. I'll say one other thing about this book that I would have appreciated having in it that wasn't there. Is so Hellenic traditions have, reconstructionist Hellenic traditions, have sort of very specific rules for approaching ritual. They have very formal ritualized structures. And this book kind of alludes to some of them very lightly, but I think, like, if you weren't familiar with those ritual structures at all, you wouldn't recognize them. So although this is not a reconstructionist
practice... Yeah, I was going to say, it's not a
reconstructionist. I know it's not a reconstructionist practice, but you're dealing with a Hellenic deity who might appreciate having her rituals done in a specific manner. You know, your mileage may vary, but it would have been nice to have those practices detailed or outlined at one point in the book.
Even if it was as an appendix.
Exactly. As like an option. Like, here's how Hecate would have been worshipped back in the day. Here's how reconstructionist Hellenics are you know, worshiping today. Right. Here's what the ritual structures look like if you want to use them. It would have been nice to have those things. Because she says things like, you know, wash up before you do the ritual. Mm-hmm. That's a thing that that comes out of reconstructed Hellenic practices where ritual cleanliness was very important because you could accrue sort of spiritual dirt right. over the course of living. Mm-hmm. So before you do a Hellenic ritual, you have to spiritually and physically clean yourself mm-hmm. in specific ways. She just says, wash up before you do a ritual. And I don't think that people who are unfamiliar with Hellenic practices, which many of the people reading right. this book will not be because That's it's true. Not a reconstructionist practice. Mm-hmm. I don't think a lot of people are necessarily going to know what she's talking about or what she's alluding to. Mm-hmm. So I think that information would have been useful for people.
I would agree with that because I will say I attempted the first ritual, which is an initiation ritual to start the course, right?
Right.
And it says wash up. And then do this thing. It's like a 15-minute kind of.
Yeah.
I started with just washing my hands and kind of splashing my face. And I did the ritual and I felt like reject. it was like reject. No.
Unacceptable.
Absolutely unacceptable. I was like, okay. So I waited until the next day, which was still part of the new moon. Mm-hmm. I took a full shower, you know, and then went directly to my altar mm-hmm. and did the whole ritual again. And then I got, yes, here is your key.
Congratulations, so, you did it right this time.
You did it right this time. So yeah, I think an explanation of what does washing up mean? Does it mean a full ritual bath or
is just washing your hands
enough? Or is just washing your hands enough? And at least in my experience of that, just washing up, quote unquote, just mm-hmm. washing your hands, you know, just kind of tidying yourself up was not enough.
Yeah, I'm not surprised by that because like mm-hmm. I said, you know, Hecate is a Hellenic deity.
Yep.
And she's been worshipped in these particular ways for a long time. Mm-hmm. There are just ritualized structures for doing mm-hmm. this that I have to assume mm-hmm. would make it easier to get in contact. Mm-hmm. I did appreciate about this book, because you mentioned that it was like a really short ritual. I did appreciate that the rituals in this book were sort of varied. Mm-hmm. So there were some that were very long and involved. Yep. There were some that were very short and contained. I appreciated that. Mm-hmm. You know, I liked that element of it.
So I have one question, and I'm going to ask you all for your stars.
Okay.
Because I didn't read this book.
Right, right.
That first initiation is to the course or to Hecate?
Yeah.
It is, I guess it depends on how you look at it. It is kind of a combination of the two. It's an intention to begin this course, which is it takes a year and a day, so that at the end you can be self-initiated as a devotee of Hecate.
Okay, at the end.
Yeah.
Not at the end of the initiation, but at the end of the course.
Yeah. Yes. If I had to describe it.
Because if it was like an initiation to Hecate as the first thing.
No.
I'd be like, what the fuck?
No, it's initiation to, but for me, she extended her first key. What would
token?
It be? Well, as a dedicant.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
If you will, as a dedicant.
If I had to describe it, I probably wouldn't describe that first ritual. I know it is described in the book as an initiation, mm-hmm. I think. But if I had to describe it, I would probably call it a dedication rather than an initiation.
Yeah.
Right now I am a dedicant on the modern Hecatean witchcraft path.
Okay. Yep.
In a year and a day, assuming I finish the course.
Then you will do a self-initiation.
Then I will do a self-initiation to become a devotee of Hecate.
And I did appreciate that this book was very clearly geared towards solitaries.
Yes.
Sometimes there's a lot of times where you'll get these books and it's like, and you're going to have to find a mentor who can initiate you. Yep. And you're like, well,
she's very adamant about being inclusive to people, regardless of who they are, because she's very cognizant of the issues going on in, you know, with trans witches and people like that. So she definitely wants to, or at least attempts to make it clear that this is open to anyone. You don't have to be a woman. You don't, you know, it can be men, it can be women, it can
There are no qualifiers.
There are no qualifiers.
Okay, stars ratings.
I'd say as a book, I would give it 3 stars.
Okay.
Because there are some muddy parts, there are some mm-hmm. things that could be qualified. As a course, I'm going to give it 4.
Oh.
Give it 1 star. Yeah. I didn't like it. I didn't enjoy the process of reading it.
Okay, so that's we'll fair. Make that like 2.5 stars between the two of you mm-hmm. all. So
as a rounded out. Yep. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So for 3 pagans and a cat, this book is a...
Eh.
Depending on who you
soft,
are.
Eh.
Depending on who you are.
Right. So if you're Gwyn, buy it. If you're Ode, don't.
Yeah.
If you're me, I don't know what to tell
don't,
you.
Don't bother.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, and I have no interest in Hecate and witchcraft being right, interested, right. So it's yep. a little bit of a thing, but.
Leave us right. out, Car.
That's it for the reviews.
I'm impressed. That was you a nice managed one. To keep well, the actual, like the key and everything.
You know, I had a cough drop. Very
good. Very good.
So.
And then the other thing we wanted to talk about, which is not really a review, it's a thank you.
Yeah.
to.
Wonderful Body Co.
She sent us this wonderful gift of Bath and Body products and
in the mail.
Yeah, yep. We were not expecting that at all.
No, it just arrived.
Yep, and it was it's Bath and Body products. So we've got
salts.
Basically bath salts, yeah. And that are book inspired. So they're inspired from different books.
Some of them are book.
Well, like the ones I'm looking at are book inspired.
Yeah,
like one is called Herbs Gone Wild by Diane Kidman. Another's Outlander by Diana Gabaldon. And another one is Lavender Morning by Jude Devereaux. Those are,
yep.
you know, and so
there
they
was
each...
one that was.
I got Gwyn and I split these up.
Yes,
so the ones that I have on hand are the coffee house one, which smells like coffee.
Mm-hmm.
That's and, always good,
right? And a Hagrid one, which is inspired by the character from Harry Potter.
Harry Potter, yeah. And then she also sent along fragrance oils.
Yeah, little like roll-on fragrances.
Yeah, fragrance oils,
and yeah, really which are nice. Very nice.
And so that's wonderfulbodyco.com.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
And, yeah, book-inspired soaks and scrubs. Says it
yeah,
right on the
yeah,
cover.
And we would, I highly recommend you going to check it out. I'll take pictures of the products
and
maybe put a link up in the blog
yep.
so that you can check her stuff out because this is really nice. The scents are wonderful. My skin felt really nice and soft after I took a bath with one of the salts, you know, mm-hmm. and I love the fragrance oils.
And so. If you're like me and you don't take a bath, what I did was
yep.
I...
Shower person.
I'm
all
a shower
the way.
Person, 100%. I haven't taken a bath since I was like 8 years old.
I don't think I've taken a bath since I was 8
yeah.
years old.
So I like put a little bit of the salt in the palm of my hand when I get into the shower, and then I just get it wet so it like releases the fragrance,
mm-hmm.
and then I do like a really quick what's it called when
an exfoliation
with the salt on my
yeah.
skin,
yeah,
and then just you know let it melt in my hand.
Yeah,
interesting.
So there's various ways to use these. Highly recommend it. Check it out. And thank you. We were not expecting this at all.
Yeah,
and it was a beautiful surprise, and we just want to thank you.
I knew I knew something was coming.
Yeah,
right.
I just didn't know what.
Yep,
mystery box.
So thank
yeah.
you to our listener who is the owner of
Wonderful Body Co.
Yep.
Yeah. We enjoyed that. Okay,
yep.
let's get back to Beltane.
Okay.
Yep.
One of the things that... So, like, obviously, I'm not focusing on fertility this time.
Right.
But...
Or ever.
But it is a big focus for a lot of people, and consequently,
yeah,
Beltane is a very strongly gendered holiday.
Yes, it is. And I'd also like to mention, Car and I are actually going to be participating
yeah.
in a
well,
ritual.
Well, actually, Ode is too.
Yeah,
that's right. You're going to be too. We're actually going to be participating in a ritual that's going to be going on right after Beltane, that
mm-hmm.
weekend of Beltane, at Arts and Craft.
Yep.
It's going to be officiated by our good friends, Pat and Paul.
Yep. The owners of Arts and Craft.
The owners.
Yes.
And what they're going to do for us is, Car and I have been married for 30 years, and we wanted to do like a hand fasting as a rededication because
mm-hmm.
we're both
pagans
now. As,
right.
Since we're both pagans.
You know, they were married in a church. Now they got to do it in the
yeah,
right.
so
wilderness.
We want to
now
want
we
got to
do it right.
Uh-huh.
I mean,
so we want to reinforce, renew, redo, however you want to put it, these vows. And so they're incorporating a hand fasting for us
into this Beltane ritual,
which was originally written by
Jason Mankey.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it has been adapted, and he gave permission for this ritual to be adapted.
Yeah.
And it's beautiful. It's going to be a beautiful
ceremony.
Ritual.
Yeah,
ritual. Yeah.
So, yeah. So hand fastings are a big part of
yeah,
Beltane.
Yeah, you see a lot of that going on at Beltane. And you just see a lot of pairing off.
Mm-hmm.
Because, especially during maple dances, there's a
you
tendency
get dizzy
to...
and fall into each other's arms?
Well, that does happen.
Yeah.
That does
but there's
happen,
a
sure.
there's a tendency to sort of break the participants into two gendered groups.
Yes.
And
yes.
one gender holds one color ribbon, and the other gender
yeah.
holds the other color
mm-hmm.
ribbon, and you dance around until the maypole's all, you know, tangled up. And then you pair off, presumably.
Gotcha.
Is the idea.
It would be nice if there was a way to recreate the dance to where it was either three gender.
You know, just like, got to be really, really careful that like a swan doesn't come up and pick up one of the because then, you know, you got the little swan and chill thing going on again.
We have, I like how we have continuity now.
Yeah.
Nice.
So what I've seen in the past people do, like, you know, because there have been attempts made to sort of make a non-binary space.
Right.
And a lot of arguments about whether and where trans people should be included.
Right. And I think they should.
Right. In my stated opinion is that trans people should be included with the gender they identify
with. Exactly. Yep. Exactly. They most definitely should.
And that
shouldn't
be a controversial stance. Nope. And I'm furious that it is.
Yeah.
So as a non-binary person, obviously the thing that most applies to me is when they create sort of a third segment, right?
Yes.
That non-binary people can be a part of. But that third group doesn't usually get to be involved really in the proceedings because the proceedings are built around those two groups interacting.
Right. Right.
So the sort of non-binary third group just kind of is an attendant to those two groups and sort of facilitates the ritual instead of participating in the ritual. And that's a really uncomfortable place to put people, I think, to say, like, you don't get to be part of this. We're just going to allow you to make our ritual easier for us. And
there's
I don't know. Yeah, like, I don't know off the top of my head.
Trans flag ribbons and gay pride ribbons.
God, wouldn't that be cool?
Yeah, because then you can be like, hey, this
grab the ribbon that applies to you.
How
the
about
non-binary
polyamory ribbons? You know, why does it have to be a pairing of two people? Why couldn't it be three of various genders?
Yep.
Yeah, or six, or however many people you can handle. Like, I can't handle one partner, but if you can handle several, congrats.
Right?
So, on your relationship management skills.
Right.
I do think that, and what is it? Is it Robin who said a rainbow color ribbons, one for every person's fancy?
Yeah.
Why not?
Yeah.
You know, why do we have to pair off? I know it's traditional.
Yeah.
Maybe we need to start rethinking tradition.
Yeah.
Especially since they're not that old. These dualistic traditions, you know, most of them come from Gardner.
Yeah. Yeah. It was very, very much the modern definitely brought in this concept that it has to be a god and a goddess, a high priest and a high priestess, a man and a woman, very gendered roles.
These dualistic pairs.
These dualistic pairs. And it's like, why do we have to be so married, if you will, to that concept? Why can't we come up with something different or something new in addition to that? It's fine. You know, that's, but.
Right. And here's the thing. I don't want
to
take anybody's
abolish
fun.
It,
I don't want to take anybody's fun away from them.
Right.
And I can see how, you know, maypoles and the existing, Beltane traditions are a lot of fun, right? I can see how people enjoy that. Just there's not necessarily a clean space for me to slide into with that.
Right.
I could go in and be gendered while I'm there, but it would be uncomfortable for me. And if you're going to do a ritual, you shouldn't be uncomfortable being there. And if you're going to be uncomfortable doing it, you probably shouldn't do the ritual.
Right. Yeah.
You know? So
I think therein lies the problem is, you know, how do we make this so everybody's welcome, everybody feels comfortable? And unfortunately, it does come down to whoever is planning the ritual and what
event
their
coordinators,
and what their view is. I mean, unfortunately, there are some leaders out there, some covens out there that are very, very traditional in
their
view.
Color out if you want. We are talking about Zebu Pest, right?
Yeah,
among other
people who have quite vehemently
very rigid views.
Very rigid views. And it's a shame.
Yeah.
You know, because we need to be able to embrace what is becoming the norm now.
Right.
As opposed to what was the norm 50, 60 years ago.
Right.
And I think there's this conflict maybe between, so there are definitely some people in the community, obviously, who just don't want trans and non-binary inclusion.
Right.
Some people who don't even want homosexual inclusion, right?
Exactly.
Homosexuality is now more accepted than transsexuality and non-binary identities are in pagan spaces, but there are still, you know, places where they run into friction.
Right.
So some of that obviously comes down to just people who have already formed an opinion that they don't want this to be part of their ritual or part of their space.
Right.
But then there are some people who it just seems to be like an appeal to tradition for them.
Mm-hmm.
And for those people, I have to assume that the attachment to tradition is part of this thing we see in paganism sometimes of a desire to have a lineage.
Yeah.
A desire to have an attachment to something older than it really is. And so we're unwilling to give up or alter any of our traditions.
Yeah. Right.
Because acknowledging that they're young enough to still adapt, you know, acknowledges that they're young.
But that said, like, everything adapts.
Exactly. I mean, yeah. Just, the Catholic Church is adapting slowly, but slowly
very
but steadily.
Slowly. Very slowly.
It's interesting that you bring that up because about the wanting to hold, you know, to have ancient, you know, ties. Because I'm in a book club now online that just started reading The Spiral Dance last week. Mm-hmm. And so I started reading for the first time in almost 30 years, probably. I've started reading The Spiral Dance again. And I remember at the time thinking, wow, this is, you know, this is so cool. And then finding out, wow, this is, you know.
So fake.
So fake. Actually, so no, I take it back. It was 20 years ago that I read this because it comes off as history.
Right.
And it's not. It's her. And she says it in the 20th anniversary introduction to the book, because it was originally published in 1979. She talks about the fact that when she originally envisioned this, she was using data that has now been debunked.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But also she intentionally did it as a kind of...
she mythologized.
Yeah, she mythologized what she thought it would have been like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if there was a matriarchal... goddess worshiping society, which was a popular theory put forth by an anthropologist
Margaret
of the
Murray.
Day. Yeah, Margaret Murray. Well, actually, she's the one who influenced Gardner. There's another one who had this whole idea of a matriarchal, ancient matriarchal society, and that's what Starhawk and a lot of others like her latched onto back in the day. And so you read it now, knowing that all of that has been debunked and that we don't have these ancient ties of a religion of witchcraft or a religion of Wicca that has been passed down for thousands of years. I can sort of see why people would like to have that, because you've got your mainstream religions of Christianity and Islam and Judaism.
Right, that are like, we've been around for 2,000 years.
Yeah, Hinduism and Buddhism. You know, they've got ties that go back very far.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have a young religion like Wicca, you want it to feel legitimate because so many people tell you it's not.
Right.
You know.
But looking for your validation from what are functionally, because of the fact that they're proselytizing, enemy religions.
Right. They're enemy religions.
That's not the right place to look for your validation. You don't need their validation to be okay.
Exactly. And the thing I think it seems like people are starting to realize now, although I do occasionally run into people who still have this idea of witchcraft as
ancient,
being
unbroken
an ancient
lineages.
Unbroken lineage. And it's like, no, but there may be some folk magic traditions.
Right.
You know,
there were certainly people practicing magic
exactly.
in the ancient past.
There were people, magic itself, witchcraft as the practice
existed,
of the
right.
craft has existed for thousands of years. It just hasn't existed as a religion.
Right.
You know, as a you know, you have practices and folk traditions and things like that,
often get integrated into other systems.
And they get integrated into other systems, into inter-Christianity quite a bit. Those are what has been handed down through families.
Right.
Yep.
And things like that. These traditions that were passed on from grandma to grandma, you know, like I have folk traditions that were passed down to me, even though my family was Christian, you know. But there were magical folk traditions that were passed down to me from my German side of the family. And that's,
they were folk traditions.
Exactly.
I
don't come from a long line of witches because
the
I
fact
was taught.
That the fact that your German-derived grandmother taught you X, Y, or Z about gardening and it has a magical explanation doesn't mean that you come from an ancient German witch line. It just means that your grandmother knew some folk magic.
Exactly.
That she probably didn't even think of as folk
magic.
She
didn't. And the same with my grandfather teaching me to water witch.
Uh-huh.
He didn't think of that as witchcraft.
No,
he was a Christian. He was a Baptist.
And he probably called it dowsing.
And he did. He called it dowsing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and to him it was a
science.
A
thing.
Science.
Yeah.
Thing.
Right. It's how the earth connected. Uh-huh.
You know,
geomagnetic fields.
Yeah.
And
exactly. So, but I think if we can get past this idea that we need to have this grand history and embrace the fact that, yes, witchcraft itself as a practice has been around for thousands of years.
I tell you what, guys, embrace the fact that 2,000 years from now, these will be ancient religions.
That's right.
But they all start 2,000 years in the past. Embrace the fact that you are living in the past for your religion. Exactly. Which means you get to define the direction it goes in. That's a great place to be. We're in on the ground floor of these religions.
Right? I mean, you know,
we get to decide what matters to them.
Like, Wiccan listeners out there, you know, some people get really sad or touchy about the fact that Wicca is a young religion. It's like, but yeah, 2,000 years from now,
it'll be old.
It'll be old.
And
Gardner will be its father. I mean, you know.
Someday you'll be an ancestor and somebody will be praying to you at their altar.
Exactly.
In the ways that you pass down now.
Exactly.
With the habits and rituals you're establishing.
And I think it's the same for Reconstruction religions such as Druidry.
Reclaiming. Reconstructions and revivals are an interesting sort of middle position where, like, we do have ancient sources, admittedly fragmented ancient sources. And we'll be 2,000 years from now, hopefully, in a better position than we are now.
Right.
But, like, the religions did exist at one time, and then there was a stop.
Yep.
Right.
And a long period of silence with occasional murmuring.
Yep.
And now.
Yeah.
Right. Where we're trying to resuscitate the corpse like that. Isis and Osiris.
Yep, exactly.
All I can say is, like, there's two things that we need to make sure of.
Okay.
Especially if we are the grandparents of new forming religions,
right, exactly.
To some extent.
We are the ancestors, of future popes.
Of future people.
So we need to, A, make sure that our historical stuff is as complete as possible.
Exactly, absolutely. And as accurate
and
as possible.
Which
is why
good documentation is critical.
Which is why I think creating your own Book of Shadows or Grimoire is important.
Yes.
Right.
And B, don't do stupid-ass UPG. So your unverified personal gnosis, make sure it's, like, at least somewhat lines up with stuff that others have.
Right. That's what we call, like, shared personal gnosis.
Right. Shared personal gnosis.
When your UPG and another person's UPG kind of line up.
Yeah.
I'm not going to invalidate anyone's UPG for their personal practice, but for setting the ground rules of the religion at large, shared personal gnosis is the order of the day.
Right.
UPG is for personal practice.
Yep. Right.
Shared personal gnosis is for defining sort of the boundaries of a religion.
Right.
That's what I'm getting at.
I agree.
Going back to Cindy Brannan's Hecatean, you know, modern Hecatean witchcraft, I do know that a lot of the gnosis that she has adopted is shared gnosis with other Hecatean witches who practice modern Hecatean witchcraft.
Gotcha.
So it's not just all personal gnosis, it's a shared gnosis from a movement that has been going on for a while now.
But is it a movement she started?
It is.
Is it she? When she
started? She started it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anne Mora started, Green Wicca, if you will.
Right, right.
Yes, which means that ultimately everything goes back to Anne Mora.
Yep.
It is a modern practice. It is not a reconstruction or reclaiming.
Yeah.
So,
all right.
Revival.
Yeah.
Yeah. Reclaiming is a specific tradition related to fairy, so I prefer revival.
Okay, so it's not a revival.
Yeah.
So, guess what?
What?
Odes! Stone! Corner!
He stares at the ceiling while he does this. It's very interesting.
And he
That's because
very,
the
very
mic
red.
Drops down from the ceiling that you have to grab.
It's
in his imagination.
He's imagining the ring.
We are suddenly in a ring.
Yes. So the mic drops down from the center. You grab it.
And you scream
and you
into
announce it. Yes.
For today, because Beltane, fire festivals, bonfires, etc.
Yep.
I'm going to be talking about fire agate. Recently, in Grandfather Fire, I talked about fire quartz. And previously, before this, I've talked about carnelian. And I'm going to talk about how all these things are both the same and different.
Okay.
So, fire agate is a type of chalcedony. Chalcedonies and agates are structurally the same thing, essentially, but agates have banding and chalcedonies don't. So, what makes this a fire agate is the fact that it has banded qualities. It's a type of chalcedony. It's only found in Mexico and the southwest United States, so in like Arizona, California, New Mexico, and in northern and central Mexico. And it was created because in that area, around 30 million years ago, there was a lot of volcanic activity, a lot of massive volcanic activity. And the land was so broken up and superheated that over time, there were these layers building up of iron oxide and silica. Very, very thin layers of iron oxide building up over time, and then silica, and then iron oxide, and then silica, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, until the iron oxide eventually ran out, and then it was just layers of chalcedony, which is quartz-derived, building up on top of it as the volcanic activity continued.
Mm-hmm.
Fire agate has a really distinctive appearance due to these layers of iron oxide and silica in the structure. The colors can range from blue-green to yellow to red, but mostly with fire agates, you'll see them in a red range, and they're usually found on a brown to black body stone.
Okay.
Right? And then inside, quote, inside the stone, you'll see like a glow, which will have the iridescent colors inside, which are the light refracting through the different layers of the silica and the iron oxide.
Okay.
Let me make sure I understood you. You could have a fire agate that's blue?
You could, yes.
Cool.
Well, think about it. The hottest part of a fire is blue.
Yeah.
Very true.
So, and some fire agates will have all of these colors.
Cool.
Sort of in a kaleidoscopic rainbow of all the color variations. They actually, if you're like looking for a visual, they look a lot like black opals.
Okay.
Like Lightning Ridge black opals.
Yep.
But they're fire agates, and they're only found in this one part of the world. The fire agates you're most likely to see in pagan stores in tumbled form are going to be sort of a brown color. They're going to have an orange to red color iridescence. And often they'll have sort of a cracked or a scaled appearance, because during the volcanic activity, there was a lot of fissures in the stone that were then filled in with layers of chalcedony.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll have these little like craquelars and scaled patterns in the stone that are usually like a whiter color. That's the clear chalcedony that filled in after the iron oxide ran out. Fire agates obviously have a fire connection. Unlike their sister stone, carnelian, because carnelians are orange to red chalcedony that is not banded. That's the only distinction between an agate and a chalcedony, is that agates have banding. So carnelians that have banding, that edge into having bands of color, are actually red agate rather than being carnelians. So like the process of getting the one stone from the other stone is basically just how the individual specimen appears. Like, chemically, they're the same.
Gotcha.
Carnelians, for one reason or another, are very, very, like, active, productive, energetic stones.
Mm-hmm.
Fire agates are less, they're still very energetic, but they're more stable than a carnelian is. They have more of a protective quality to them.
Okay.
So I think you would find them more useful for Beltane, because you have that sort of protective emphasis during Beltane.
Right.
You would prefer a fire agate as your firestone to this, to a carnelian, because fire agate's more in tune with like shielding and protecting and the sort of productive aspects of fire. Right.
Time to go stone shopping.
Whereas carnelians are a little more aggressive.
Right.
Fire agates are very creative. They're very, very potent fire symbols.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the same way as fire quartz. So fire quartz is like a captured flame almost. And fire agate is what I would call like an embodied flame, if that makes sense.
Yep, yeah. It does.
Okay. And fire agates are very good if you're trying to make spiritual progress. They're good for what I call fire feeding. So this is a little like meditation I like to do, basically, where I envision sort of my core from which my shield extends as a flame. Mm-hmm. And when I start to get worn down, I can take a stone like a fire agate and absorb some of that fire into myself, feed the fire within myself from the much larger store of fire in the fire agate.
That's it for O's Stone Corner!
How it like
petered out.
It's now a challenge, basically, to see how long you can hold it.
Yeah, I need to prepare myself better.
Got to take a deeper breath.
Deeper breath. Yeah.
Diaphragmal breathing.
Sit up straight. Yeah. Don't slouch in your chair.
Yep. All right. For next time, I'll remember. It's gonna like be all blah
blah blah.
Oh my goodness.
Is there anything else you all wanted to talk about?
Well, I do think it's time for Cars Feast Table.
Cars Feast Table.
Jeez, every time. I tried really hard not to Google that time, and it didn't help.
Didn't work.
I came up this time with elderflower fritters.
I'm intrigued.
Me too.
All right. So it's an egg.
Okay.
a cup of self-rising fleur.
Okay.
Or flour.
Right.
Fleur. Fleur is my preferred pronunciation on that.
A teaspoon of rose water.
Ooh. Okay. I like anything with rose water in it.
A quarter teaspoon of cinnamon.
We have rose water.
Oh, right. It's flower blossom.
A quarter teaspoon of cinnamon. Okay.
Mm-hmm. A quarter cup of honey.
Ooh.
2 cups of elderflowers, freshly picked and cleaned.
See, we gotta get our...
We gotta get an elderberry.
And 2 tablespoons, or in my opinion, as much as you want, of brandy.
Ooh. Oh, nice.
So you mix the egg, the rose water, the honey, and the brandy in a medium-sized bowl. Stir in the flour and cinnamon. The batter should resemble like slightly thick pancake batter.
Okay.
If the batter is too thin, add more flour. If it's too thick, add more
and
brandy.
More brandy, yeah. Yeah.
That's exactly right. Then you fold in the elderflowers and you fry them like pancakes. Or you can drop spoonfuls into a deep fryer and kind of get like a hush puppy type effect on them.
Hakaneko wants to know if you can do it with dandelions instead of elderflowers because she doesn't have elderflowers.
You most certainly can.
Excellent.
You can, you can.
I wonder if I could do it with lavender.
So, you serve those with a sprinkling of orange water and fresh lemon.
Oh my goodness.
Or you dip them into fresh sweet cream.
Oh my God. Either of those sounds like a great option.
Makes about 2 dozen. If you don't have self-rising flour, you can always add 1 teaspoon of baking powder and 1/2 teaspoon of salt.
Okay. Does it need to be white flour?
Probably.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Yep. Probably.
If you can't find elderflowers, you can use any other kind of flour that's edible.
Okay.
Or a cup of finely diced apple with a hint of fresh mint.
Ooh. I could do that too.
Heck yeah.
And these elderflower fritters actually come from medieval England.
Oh, they're an old recipe.
And there are magical things, attributes to them.
Tell us the magical attributes.
So protection from fair folk.
Okay.
Trust, beauty, energy for attraction, and magical ambiance.
Nice. So, well, you know, you can actually, I've looked into this, you can actually order organic elderflowers.
Online.
Yeah. At Amazon, even.
Yeah.
So we might be ordering some elderflowers from Amazon.
We can, give this a try. Know,
plant our own tree.
I want to do the heavy cream, to dip them in the heavy cream.
Yeah. Heavy sweet cream.
Yeah,
heavy
that
sweet
cream. That sounds so nice.
Yeah.
I'm into that.
Oh my goodness.
In that case, we have to do the drop ones kind of, I would think, rather than cakey one.
Yeah.
You know, rather than pancakes.
So that you can, you know, pick them up.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Although I guess you could do like a crepe. Like if you do a thin pancake and sort of roll it up and...
Well, if you do, if you're going to do a crepe.
Right.
Do it with ricotta in the middle.
Ooh.
May or, not be, you know, medieval.
Or you put the, or you put the heavy sweet cream on top of
it. Uh-huh, and then roll it up.
Yeah, so.
I'm seeing many ways we could enjoy these.
We're going to experiment with these.
Beltane breakfast. Okay.
Those sound very good, Carr.
Those sound very, very good.
So apparently...
I think that's your best one yet.
Oh,
it
thanks.
Is. I do think so. Myrmidith. How do you say Myrmidith?
Myrmidith
is suggesting making a lavender simple syrup. And make a whipped cream. And we have,
lavender simple syrup right now.
Let me just say that if you do it correctly, you can put the lavender simple syrup into the whipped cream instead of vanilla.
Yeah.
That would be...
Especially if you're making your own whipped cream.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know if you all know, but you can buy, like, canisters on Amazon that have inserts in them
to aerosolize.
That would be fucking.
I had no idea.
You literally just pour heavy cream into it, and then whatever flavor you want,
simple
put the cap back on it, and you
shake it.
Yep. Oh my god! I need to buy this.
That's so much easier than making.
Oh god, we could make our own chocolate.
Because it was when I was at Ground Sphere that I did that.
Remember? That's right. I do remember that.
Yep. See
we should make our own chocolate whipped cream that way.
We should.
That way we know it's going to be good and not gross.
But yeah. We got a chocolate whipped cream. I won't name the brand because I'm not going to shame them, but it was not good. It tasted like metal.
It was terrible. It was the bad. Okay. I'm on board with
We're going to get some of these and make our own whipped cream.
Yep. Absolutely.
Now for our commercial from our Tiger Reel. And Relic Designs. Spelled R-E-L-L-I-K Designs. Relic Designs produces wired wrap jewelry from amethyst points wrapped with coils of silver to bracelets of braided bronze and silver chainmail links. Reel works with all types of metals from copper to titanium and accepts custom commissions. You can find Relic Designs on Facebook at Relic Designs or on Instagram at Relic.Designs. There are a couple of imposter relic designs out there, so make sure you get the dots and the spaces right and accept no substitutes relic designs.
That's right.
Heck yeah. Mm-hmm. Your commercials were on point this time.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad.
Very good.
I felt like the energy was low for the last set.
So I think that's everything. That's everything I wanted to talk about anyway.
Mm-hmm. I've actually closed out all the rest of my...
Yeah, because I think Shiznit. Because, and if you haven't listened to the Beltane episode that we did last year, I recommend you do it because it actually has a lot of information.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I did.
I forgot.
That we have forgotten about.
I did want to shout out the Beltane Fire Society in Scotland. They put on a huge, essentially performance art ritual for Beltane at Calton Hill.
I have seen video of this.
Every year. And it looks like the coolest shit ever. Mm-hmm. It's a bunch of volunteer actors, essentially, and they all get dressed up as various, like, mythological creatures, and they put on these performances as the May Queen and King procession goes around and wakes up the various, like, sets of the performers.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And the audience just mingles in with the performance. So it looks like it would be a really great event. So if you're in Scotland, head up to Edinburgh and find Calton Hill and go do that, because it looks like the coolest shit ever.
Yep.
And it happens on Beltane, so.
Cara and I have actually seen some short videos on that were promoting the event.
Yeah.
It looks, and we were like, someday.
Someday we got to get to Scotland.
We got to get to Scotland to see
on
this
Beltane.
For Beltane.
Right.
They do a Samhain one, too, but they started with Beltane.
They started with Beltane. Yep. Very cool.
And they've been doing it for 30 years.
Oh, that's amazing.
We could just move to Scotland for a little bit.
I think that was Casper.
It was.
Started with Scottish and fell into Liverpudlian. Yeah, it's okay.
You always fall into Casper, though. Anytime you're doing any kind of UK accident, you gradually fall
accident?
Into Casper.
An accident. A UK accident.
You gotta
spend more time listening to how Paul talks, and then you can mimic his accent instead of always falling
Which
into Casper.
Which still isn't gonna be Scottish.
Right.
Yeah.
No, it's still Scottish,
but it might be a not Casper English.
That's true. Yeah, expand the UK repertoire.
Expand the repertoire.
All right.
I think we're done.
If you want to find us, you can find us on the web.
Yep. Yeah.
At www.thenumber3pagansandacat.com. If you want any of our other links, you can find them all there.
Yep.
Imagine that. You don't have to
memorize.
You don't have to memorize any of these. And I'm thinking maybe we should end this podcast because now I'm just starting to get a little weird.
Loopy?
Okay.
So
He's still recovering from his work trip.
Yeah, go to the website. And all of the links are there for absolutely everything, including our Patreon, our Redbubble, our Twitter, our Facebook,
YouTube. Oh, I've just got a new blog posted for the Agora for Patheos.
So here's the deal, folks, on the Agora blog. We post those to our Twitter and to our Facebook page. If you all would be so kind as to share them from the Agora blog when you share them, that would be great because that ups the share count. And makes them think that we're important. So help Patheos think we're important.
I am not a cook. He's doing the whole Nixon thing over here. No, but that way Patheos knows that, you know, there's interest in the blogs, then we could eventually be given a Patheos channel rather than writing for just the Agora blog.
Right, yep.
So...
And I believe that's it.
Yep.
Happy Beltane and whatever it is in the Southern Hemisphere.
Yeah, we keep blowing up the Samhain.
So they're doing Samhain right now. Go listen to our Samhain episode if you're in the Southern Hemisphere.
That's right. Our wonderful Southern Hemisphere listeners. Someday we'll get it right.
Maybe. I doubt it. We'll never get it right. It's all good. All right. I'm going to stop the podcast.
Okay. Yep.
Really?
You've been listening to Three Pagans and a Cat. Find out more information at www.3pagansandacat.com.